have a guest speaker from, he came all the way down from Rockville, Maryland, and he was nice enough to agree to let me intrude on his time off down here. Dr. Pocinki, he's a general internist in private practice in Rockville, Maryland. He has been interested in the joint hypermobility syndromes and related autonomic and sleep disorders since the late 1990s and speaks regularly on these subjects at local and national meetings, including those of the Ehlers-Danlos Society and Dysautonomia International. His publications include co-authoring major articles on the evaluation and management of fatigue and autonomic dysfunction in Ehlers-Danlos patients, which were published in 2017. He has received a variety of awards and recognition for service to his profession, as well as for the quality of his practice. He received his medical degree from Cornell University Medical College and is a fellow of the American College of Physicians. He also serves with me on the EDS Comorbidity Coalition, and that's how I roped him in. So, come on up, Dr. Pocinki. We're very honored to have you join us tonight.
All right. Okay, let's make sure all the parts are working. Okay, that's working. And slides are working. Okay, great. So, unfortunately, first I do have to say that I will be discussing some off-label uses of medications, and fortunately or unfortunately, I have no financial conflicts of interest to report because unfortunately there are no big pharmaceutical companies that are interested in the plight of Ehlers-Danlos patients who would support speeches. This is not particularly relevant to tonight's talk, but it's hard to find cartoons that are... Why is that on top of the other slide? Okay. Anyway, so this guy is working with his masseuse or perhaps physical therapist, and he says, I'm just worried that the knots are the only thing holding me together. So those of you, and this is a common problem for patients working with physical therapists who aren't savvy about the hypermobility syndromes, that They see knotted up muscles and tight muscles and are overzealous in trying to get them to loosen up without realizing that might be further destabilizing the joints. But on to sleep problems. So you'll see in a few minutes why you need an introduction to the autonomic nervous system in order to understand why sleep is haywire in patients with Ehlers-Danlos, related hypermobility syndromes, and related autonomic nervous system disorders. So as a very basic introduction, the autonomic nervous system regulates all body processes that go on automatically. So heart rate, blood pressure, breathing, digestion, regulation of body temperature, all these things that fortunately you don't have to think about. They're happening automatically while you're sitting here. Autonomic dysfunction turns out to be a very common feature of Ehlers-Danlos and other hypermobility-related syndromes, by which I would include things like fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue syndrome. And autonomic dysfunction underlies a lot of the symptoms. Tonight we'll just be focusing on sleep, and I'm going to show you that the most common type of sleep disorder we see in patients with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, I think, has an autonomic basis. So the autonomic nervous system is a pretty simple system. They find it convenient, easy to explain to people that it's kind of like having an accelerator and a brake. Pretty much all your body systems run at a certain speed. If you need to, you can speed them up. If you need to, you can slow them down. If you start exercising, you're going to kick in a little adrenaline. You're going to hit the gas. You're going to raise your heart rate and blood pressure to send more blood to your muscles. If you're going to sleep or you've just eaten, hopefully you're going to take your foot off the gas and you're going to stimulate your brake or your parasympathetic nervous system. So the major concept, the crux of autonomic dysfunction in these syndromes is what I call failure to modulate. Now, when the autonomic nervous system is working properly, your body detects small changes in things like heart rate or blood pressure or body temperature and says, okay, gee, you know, blood sugar's gotten a little bit low. We need to bring it back up again a little bit. And things stay in a very narrow range. autonomic dysfunction in these syndromes, the opposite happens. You don't stay in a normal, you're going haywire, or what I often refer to as the autonomic roller coaster. So, and the central paradox, and I call this talk a panoply of paradoxes, meaning a whole collection, you'll hear me use that word half a dozen times, is that very counterintuitively, the more run down, overtired, stressed out, what I call depleted you get, the more your autonomic nervous system overreacts to minor stresses. So you'd think, gee, I'm exhausted, little things are just gonna sort of bounce off me without my even noticing them. And in fact, in these syndromes, just the opposite happens. So you're exhausted, and your body keeps, the energy you're trying to save gets wasted with your body overreacting to every little stress that comes along. And unfortunately, what often happens is then your body has this overreaction that says, well, wait a minute, now the heart rate's going up too much, blood pressure's going up too much, you better slow down. And of course, you don't slow down like this, you slow down like this. And then it's, whoa, wait a minute, now the heart rate's too low, blood pressure's too low, we better hit the gas again. And here's what that roller coaster looks like. So I won't show you all the details of this, except I think a good illustration, if I can get this pointer. There it is. Okay. So if we look right here in this part of this test, and this is a simple in-office test where we can measure parasympathetic and sympathetic function independently. So at this point in the test, I've lost my cursor again. This is when we ask the patient to stand. So I hate to use the word normal, the N word, but in a normal person, your body makes a short increase. As you stand, your blood pressure drops, blood flow to your brain drops a little bit, your body kicks in a little extra adrenaline, raises your heart rate, raises your blood pressure, but then almost immediately your body does a bunch of other things. It mobilizes blood that's been sitting around unused into the circulation, it constricts blood vessels a little bit, so very quickly you're able to take your foot off of the gas and reach a new equilibrium point. And people with autonomic problems, what happens is they overreact. So stand up, blood flow to the brain drops, your body panics, hits the gas too hard, and then your body says, well, wait a minute, now the blood pressure's going up too much, the heart rate's going to be better, slow down, and almost instantaneously hit the brake even harder. And that's the basic physiology of orthostatic intolerance, or how people with autonomic problems faint. And if you understand that, you understand more about orthostatic intolerance than most cardiologists do. So again, the paradox here is this explains why we use medications like beta blockers to reduce lightheadedness and syncope. Because if you block the up, you won't get that big drop. Again, totally counterintuitive, because your blood pressure is so low that you feel like you're going to faint. Why would you take a medicine that lowers your blood pressure? And the answer is because you want to block that. And you see here that then it doesn't stop with this. Then the brake, wait a minute, okay, now it's too low, I better hit the gas. No, that's too much gas, I better hit the brake again. Now it's too much brake, I better hit the gas again. And this person's been standing for 5 minutes and her body still can't get her heart rate and blood pressure regulated. And also, look at how much energy she's wasted compared to this little bit that the healthy person makes. So this roller coaster during the day is actually a factor in fatigue. So I like to include this slide to make the point that this crazy chaos on the left represents an imbalance rather than a permanent condition. So this is a patient who was severely ill, could barely get out of bed, too lightheaded to stand, cognitive impairment, everything you can think of. And in her case, it took us a year and a half to get things back in balance, but you could see that after a year and a half of treating her pain and her depression and her autonomic problems and improving her sleep, all the things people need to do to get better, that her autonomic function looks pretty close to the normal picture from the previous slide. So this is probably the most important part of this talk to understand. So this is, wasn't easy to find a normal. This is sleep stages during the night. So normally your body cycles through sleep stages that last about an hour and a half to 2 hours. most of your deep sleep is in the first two cycles. So shallow sleep, deep sleep, shallow REM, shallow sleep. Usually there's a little more deep sleep here. Shallow REM. So you can see there's this fairly regular cycle with most of the deep sleep early in the night. This is a very typical pattern that we see in Ehlers-Danlos patients. They say, gee, I don't have any trouble falling asleep. I sleep through the night okay. I'm not choking and gasping. I don't have sleep apnea. I'm not thrashing around. I'm not in pain. I'm not having wild nightmares all night. But I wake up in the morning feeling totally unrefreshed. I feel like I haven't slept. And so, well, okay, why? So first of all, you can see no deep sleep. So that's part of the problem. What you can't see here is that in the sleep lab, we define an awakening as a disruption to the continuity of your sleep that lasts more than 30 seconds. Most people have to be awake for 2 minutes to remember having been awake. So this person remembered waking up twice. She actually woke up 23 times. If your sleep is disrupted for less than 30 seconds, we call that an arousal. She had 125 arousals. So you don't see that on here, but the continuity of her sleep was disrupted 150 times in the 6.5 hours that she slept. So more sleep paradoxes. Surprising number of patients who have these syndromes report that they sleep fine. Again, I don't have trouble breathing, I don't have wild nightmares, I don't toss and turn and thrash around at night. I'm a great sleeper, I can sleep anytime, anywhere. I can sleep 10, 12, 14 hours, no problem. And sometimes I'll say, well, you know, I think that actually means you're not sleeping well. That often I get an argument. I was like, no, really, if you can sleep 12 hours and wake up and say, gee, I could go back to sleep for 2 more hours, something's wrong with your sleep. So I say, do you feel rested when you get up? And the usual answer is, well, I guess so. So then I say, well, do you feel like you just want to roll over and go back to sleep for 2 more hours? And the answer, of course, is, yeah, doesn't everybody? And then there are people who say, and I just saw somebody like this yesterday, said, you know, yeah, no matter how long I sleep, I feel like I haven't slept, and I don't think I really know what feeling rested would feel like. And this misperception of sleep, again, this other patient had no idea that her sleep was disrupted 150 times. We see similar things in sleep apnea, where estimates are as many as 90% of people have sleep apnea, don't really have it, they're asleep. So this is just a slide I put in just to show that heart rate is often a good sort of proxy for sleep disruptions. You can see even from the back of the room that each of these large spikes is an awakening, and each one lines up pretty much perfectly with a spike in heart rate, as if these patients are making little spikes of adrenaline through the night. And maybe that's what's waking them. Here's a patient who is cycling through the stages of sleep okay. You can see there is a cycle here, but superimposed on that are all these vertical lines. Each time the patient gets into deep sleep, or N3, she wakes right back up into shallow sleep again. And there's whole sections of the night where she's awake, asleep, awake, asleep, awake, asleep. So heart rate variability is something a term you might come across in discussions of autonomic function. And the major paradox to understand with heart rate variability is, as I was saying earlier, the more overtired, run down, depleted you are, the more your heart rate fluctuates. So increased heart rate variability is actually a sign of impaired or lower than normal function. And that, I think I'll leave there. That's one of the more confusing ones. If you think about the heart rate fluctuations I just showed you, you can imagine that the more the heart rate is fluctuating overnight, the more disruptive your sleep is. The more disruptive your sleep is, the worse you feel in the morning. The more tired you are during the day, the more your body has got to scrape the bottom of the barrel to try to keep you going in this overtired mode, the worse your next night's sleep is going to be. This sleep study I just threw in just to show that, again, looking at heart rate, you see the heart rate is spiking up and down, and if you had a ruler, you could see that most of these persons' 25 awakenings line up with these heart rate spikes. But for whatever reason, this person's autonomic nervous system was calm and quiet for the better part of an hour, and she had a nice chunk of uninterrupted or almost uninterrupted deep sleep. The rest of the night, up, down, up, down. So the postscript, unfortunately, to this slide, which hopefully you recognize, is that this sleep study was read as normal by a board-certified sleep doctor. So this slide here is the physician is telling the patient that his head is riddled with conventional wisdom, and in fact, of course, it should be the patient dealing with a physician who has a problem thinking outside the box. So preparing this talk, I found an interesting study. So for years, one of the clues to this idea of what I call hyperarousal, that the body's making too much adrenaline overnight, is that people will describe not only having very vivid dreams and be able to recall all the details of multiple dreams during the night, but being aware of things going on around them. So patients will often say, you know, I didn't sleep at all. I heard the neighbor's kid come home at 2 in the morning. I heard the paper boy come by at 5 o'clock. And their spouse will say, you know, you were asleep the whole time. And in fact, there have been times that we see this in the sleep lab. Somebody will spend a night in the sleep lab and they will say, I didn't sleep at all. That was the worst night's sleep I've had. You know, the guy in the next bed was snoring the whole night. The technician kept coming in, and I even heard him munching on potato chips in the middle of the night. And we said, well, you know, we were monitoring your brain waves. You were asleep the whole night. You couldn't possibly have heard those things. Well, of course, first did hear those things. So one of the reasons that this previous sleep study I showed was read as normal, or the sleep doctor who read this didn't comment on the 150 arousals this person had, is a phenomenon called the first night effect. If you sleep in a strange place, the first night you're there, you tend to not sleep well. It's a strange environment, you're not sure what's going on, and this is obviously an evolutionary thing. You know, you're very wary, I better not get to too deep a sleep or some wild animal might pounce on me. So I'll just, and so for years I have called this the on alert phenomenon, that your body just is wary, something might happen, I better not let myself get too deep into sleep or something bad might happen, I won't be able to react to it. It was an interesting study done just a few years ago where they actually showed what the physiology of this problem is. And in fact, they showed that the two hemispheres of the brain behave differently during this first night effect. That one half of the brain is asleep and it's sleeping soundly and it's doing everything that sleeping brains do. The other half of the brain is not quite as asleep. It's on alert. It's what these authors call the night watch phenomenon. It's listening for deviant stimuli. It's wary that some danger is lurking that they better be ready for. So not only is this not so sleeping half of the brain more alert to things going on around it, but when it senses them, it overreacts. It's the body's warning signal, danger, that wild animal is creeping up on you, you better get ready. And so that over-response, as you remember from those red and blue graphs, is typical of the autonomic dysfunction that we see in Ehlers-Danlos. So what was different in this study was that when people came back the second night to the sleep lab, they didn't have first night effect anymore. The second night of the study, their sleep looked fine. In Ehlers-Danlos patients, it sure looks like every night is the first night. So this is a slide that people usually aren't happy with, and I probably should change it. Another paradox here is that if you need to improve your sleep, then you need to get out of this autonomic roller coaster. You need to fix what's wrong with your autonomic nervous system. And in order to improve what's wrong with your autonomic nervous system, you need to get a better night's sleep. The converse or whatever with this is that if you can get a better night's sleep, then your autonomic nervous system will improve. If you can improve your autonomic function, then your sleep will improve. So people see this and they say, okay, well, this is all well and good, but how did this person get from this crazy autonomic roller coaster to back to almost normal autonomic function? And this is where you need to look at all the underlying causes of autonomic dysfunction. And here I like to use the swimming pool analogy, or at least the gas tank analogy. And if you think about having your own energy reserves, your own gas tank, sleep is your major chance to put gas in the tank. And then when you get up in the morning, you start doing your normal activities and drawing some energy from the tank. And on a normal day, you're going to have some left at the end of the day, so you always have a reserve. So on a really stressful day, you have some extra energy in the tank and you can kick it in and sort of kick it up a notch and deal with whatever you have to deal with. Problem is, if you don't get a great night's sleep, you still have to do what you have to do the next day. And so you end up dipping into the reserves just to try to get through your day. And the problem is, again, remember your paradox. The more you dip into the reserves, the more depleted those reserves get, the more exaggerated your stress response becomes. Now, the good side of that, and you say, well, why would this, and frankly, this took me a couple years to figure out, why would this happen? Why would your body do this? So again, go back in evolution to the wild animal creeping up on you metaphor. If this animal has been chasing you for a while and you stop and hide behind a rock and try to catch your breath, and then all of a sudden you see this thing coming at you again, you want that last little bit of energy left in the tank to have a maximum effect. You don't want to feel fatigue and you don't want to feel pain. You want to be ready to do the fight or flight thing. So this is a major problem because lots of people do not realize that process is going on. As they get more and more and more depleted, their body becomes more sensitive to the little bit of adrenaline they're still able to make, and they don't realize how sick they are. And that's why in the dysautonomias, we often hear stories about, oh, I was fine until, and then I crashed and I couldn't get out of bed for months. And in almost every one of those cases, if you go back, you'll hear the story of, well, yeah, I was working, 75, 80 hours a week for probably a year before that. And and this is really, people say, okay, what do I have to get better? This little cartoon is it. You need to try and optimize the quality of your sleep and then look at what's draining energy during the day. So I'll go through these in a little bit of detail, but pain is obviously a big one. People with chronic pain tend to underestimate how much pain there is therein, but pain is a big energy drain and pain is a big sleep disruptor. Fatigue is here because whenever you're tired and you say, man, I really wanted to get this done today, and you sort of, even though you're tired, you push through it, or you hit the Diet Coke, or you do something to try and push through the fatigue and keep going, you're just making the whole thing worse. You're further depleting the reserves, you're making the whole problem worse. And unfortunately, society rewards you for pushing through it and staying those last couple hours at work or staying up late to finish something that you were supposed to finish. Dehydration, common problem. All I'll say about this is most people who are chronically lightheaded and are told to eat plenty of salt and drink plenty of water are not getting enough salt. And I'm working on a paper with that, but and even people go to major autonomic research labs and are told to drink a gallon of water a day, and that's just counterproductive. Cognitive effort still uses energy. I think most people who have fatigue know that it's just as draining to sit down and read or try to balance the checkbook or something like that as it is to, walk up three flights of stairs. Emotional stress obviously is draining. Work issues, school issues, financial stresses, family stresses, unfortunately, life in modern society, where I live in the DC area, traffic is a stress you can't get away from. And then, of course, there's everything that's going on around us in society. You can't, watching the evening news is pretty stressful. So restoring autonomic balance is really key to improving the quality of your sleep. And how do we do this? Again, as I showed you on the previous slide, we need to improve primarily the quality of sleep. A lot of people spend plenty of hours in bed. It's just the quality of their sleep is not good. Pain control is important. Again, most people tend to underestimate how much pain they're in. And sometimes when I see people initially, I'll even write them a prescription for half a dozen strong painkillers and say, just try taking some strong pain medicine at bedtime and see if you don't sleep better. That's the simplest way to know how much pain is disrupting your sleep. Obviously, don't push through the fatigue. When you're tired, take breaks. If you need to do something, you know, finish something, we'll take a break and then go back to it instead of trying to push the accelerator down to the floor and push through it. We talked about adequate salt and fluid. Blood sugar fluctuations are a problem for some people. Dropping blood sugar is a major fight or flight, panic, life or death crisis, so that's a major trigger for adrenaline that you want to try to avoid. And then when possible, minimize the other stresses in your life. 3.5 years now, I gave up my 25-mile, hour-long commute and moved my office to within walking distance of my home. I just said, okay, I got enough stress in my life. Is there some simple plan? There's some way that I could cut out some of the stresses in my life? And that was a major plus for me. Here's another picture just of all this, a patient who's just waking up a couple dozen times a night. And this is a picture of, with unfortunately, one of the first generation home sleep monitors that was great, but is no longer available. Here, the gray is shallow sleep, green is deep sleep, and the orange is awake. So you see this person tried to get into deep sleep, but didn't spend much time in deep sleep. There wasn't any more deep sleep. There is a cycle of shallow sleep and REM and shallow sleep and REM, but you see that each time this person gets in a REM, they wake up. And this is a typical pattern of somebody who is having wild dreams and vivid nightmares. And then, again, this is same patient, same home sleep monitor, about 8 months later. And this is, of course, what your sleep should look like. Shallow, deep, shallow, REM, shallow, another chunk of deep sleep, shallow, REM, the rest of the night. So let's talk about basics of treating sleep disorders. Unfortunately, we physicians are sometimes too quick to pull out the prescription pad. And as you just heard from our young speaker tonight, that good sleep hygiene is important, and something like a comfortable mattress and finding the optimal position for your joints to be in when you sleep is important. Using your bed for sleep and not spending the rest of the day in bed is important, so your body learns to associate your bed with sleep and not with other activities. A comfortable mattress is incredibly commonly overlooked. I often ask people, how old is your mattress? And they usually have no idea. And I just, as a ballpark, I would think, if you can't remember when you bought your mattress, it's probably at least 10 years old. And there are some fancy mattresses, and people sometimes, you know, various things, different things work for different people. But if an old mattress, then you're going to wake up with your joints sore and stiff. Dark and quiet is very important because, again, the overtired body tends to overreact to little bits of sound or little bits of light. I had one fellow years ago who actually moved his futon into his walk-in closet to try to minimize the amount of extraneous light and noise that was disrupting his sleep. And then I have to say something about sleep apnea and periodic limb movements, because these are the two things that sleep doctors do know how to treat, and that's what they're looking for when you go and have a sleep study. And if you don't have that, it doesn't matter how disrupted the rest of your sleep is, the sleep study report will say no significant apnea, no periodic limb movements, normal sleep study. Problem becomes that hypermobile people do tend to have an increased incidence of sleep apnea. So this is a cartoon to remind me that you really should make sure in some way or other that if you don't sleep well, that you don't have sleep apnea. So this is someone I just saw last week. This is a young woman who complained that every time she fell asleep, she woke up a minute later and couldn't breathe. And so it was presumed that she probably had sleep apnea. It sounded like she was falling asleep and her airway was closing off and she'd wake up choking and gasping. In fact, this is why this particular, this particular chart, which is what we call a hypnogram, is really vital in interpreting sleep studies. Because if you look at this without even looking at any of the labels, what jumps out at you? This second line here. You don't see much anywhere else, but this is her heart rate. And it's going up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. So here it takes her forever to fall asleep because her heart rate's gone bananas. She finally falls asleep for a little bit, even though she's awake, asleep, because her heart rate calms down a little bit. Then again, her heart rate's going bananas for a long time. She can't sleep. Finally, her heart rate calms down, and she gets a decent chunk of deep sleep. And then her heart rate starts going again. So she only slept for about 90 minutes. But that 90 minutes was enough to say, okay, this woman does not have sleep apnea. Here's, these are OAs, obstructive apnea. How many apneas did she have? Four or five? Generally up to five an hour is normal. She had a couple other hypopneas or shallow breathing. She had a couple of those. The areas are respiratory arousal. She had a couple of those. But respiratory problems are clearly not what's disrupting her sleep. It's all this chaos with her heart rate that's disrupting her sleep. So in fact, what's happening to this woman is she would fall asleep, and sleeping stimulates your parasympathetic nervous system. When you fall asleep, you take your foot off the gas and you hit the brake. She'd fall asleep, her foot would come off the gas, her heart rate and her parasympathetics would kick in, her heart rate and blood pressure would drop, and her body would panic and hit the gas. And her heart rate would go up to 140 or 160, and pressure would back up into her lungs, and she would get what we call dyspnea. It wasn't that her airway was closed off from apnea, it was that she couldn't breathe. And this was just such a classic example. And again, think back to the conventional wisdom cartoon. I got this sleep study report back with a recommendation that the patient come back to the sleep lab to be fitted with a mask for sleep apnea.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but I have a question. Was she on any medication that would have had any effect on her heart rate?
No.
Did you put her
she
on?
Has been in the past, and yes, after this, we put her back on something. I'll get to that stuff in a minute.
Okay, sorry.
That's okay. So again, you know, before we write prescriptions, think about anything, what can we do non-pharmacologically to help people get to sleep or to help people sleep better? So if they do have significant apnea, but again, be careful because apnea gets overread, then CPAP or even dental appliances can be helpful. Dental appliances are tricky in hypermobile patients because they often have TMJ problems also. And so finding somebody who can make an appliance that's good for your TMJ and good for your apnea is tricky, and take somebody with that expertise. Deep breathing is a very simple maneuver. Deep breathing stimulates your parasympathetic nervous system. If you've ever been in a situation where somebody was really upset about something, somebody else would say, you know, calm down, take a deep breath. Slow deep breathing stimulates your parasympathetic nervous system, and some people find this very helpful at bedtime. If they feel like, gee, I'm just too awake, my heart's beating too hard and too fast, they can do a slow deep breathing thing and get them to sleep. Unfortunately, the effects of that tend to wear off in a couple hours and then they may wake up. But guided imagery is another technique where basically you imagine that you're somewhere relaxing. You're lying on a beach somewhere, you're in your favorite restful, you know, hammock in the backyard, someplace that's relaxing. And you can go to that place and get away from whatever's keeping your sympathetic nervous system going. Sequential relaxation is a similar idea where you you contract and relax various muscles, muscles that tend to be tense when you're trying to fall asleep. If you tense them up completely and then relax them, they'll be more relaxed. And then very recently, there have been some descriptions of something called pink noise. So white noise, people may have heard of white noise as a background noise that helps people fall asleep. And if there's white noise in the background, then other little noises are less likely to gain your brain's attention. Pink noise has recently, in one study, shown to actually increase deep sleep. And the best I can explain, pink noise, white noise, most people hear a static, whereas pink noise is a smooth sensation. The best example I can give is people who run the fan. They run a fan in their bedroom, or they run the fan on their central heater air conditioner. That background hum really probably does have a physiologic effect. And of course, I think avoid alcohol, hopefully goes without saying. There's many reasons why people have these issues, shouldn't be drinking, but some people do resort to alcohol because it's the only thing they can get that will calm their brain down and help them fall asleep. So now we get to medications. And unfortunately, as you can see, there's lots of components to sleep problems. You know, we want to treat pain if that's an issue. Sometimes lack of deep sleep is an issue. Some people, as you saw, do try to get into deep sleep. It's just so broken that it's not restful. And finding the right combination of medications to relieve pain and reduce the heart rate and adrenaline fluctuations and optimize the amount of deep sleep is unfortunately a trial and error process, because there's really no literature. Nobody has studied this syndrome to say, okay, let's study a bunch of these people and see which medications work best. And as all of you can probably attest to, if you compared notes, different medications work for different people. So I think it would be fruitless to do a study like that. But you know, it's worth trying to get to the finish line, because when you find that right combination and start getting a decent restful night's sleep, then everything else starts to get better. And finally, we're at the point where the latest generation of home sleep monitors and Fitbits and Apple Watches and the like are starting to have some pretty reliable data. So they may not pick up on every 5 or 10 second arousal that's disrupting your sleep, but if your Fitbit says that you are waking up 10 to 15 times a night, then you're probably waking up 20 or 25. But that at least gives you an idea of, okay, there's something wrong with my sleep. I'm not imagining this. Really, I'm waking up a lot. And it also gives you a way of assessing your response to treatment. Then you can start medication and say, okay, gee, you know, I was getting 10 to 15 awakenings a night, and now I'm down to 2 or 3 a night. Even though I don't feel super refreshed when I wake up in the morning, clearly the quality of sleep must be better. And those people just need to be patient. I saw one the other day, I was like, okay, when was the last time you had a decent night's sleep? You haven't slept well in 20 years. Even if tonight we could fix what's wrong with your sleep, you wouldn't wake up tomorrow feeling great. That's going to take some time to replenish the tank. So medications, I think, for the sake of time, I have some slides that goes through in detail how I use a lot of these different medications. I don't think I'm going to go through every slide and read them. They'll obviously be in the slide set. They'll be in the video of this. But the basics of medication are primarily to block or offset that extra adrenaline that's keeping you out of deep sleep, that's disrupting that's keeping you in this fight or flight, on alert, night watch situation. After that, blocking histamine is important. So some of you may have mast cell issues. Mast cell dysfunction has been recognized in the last 5 years or so to be a fairly common associated condition with Ehlers-Danlos and the hypermobility syndromes. And the major chemical that mast cells release when they react is histamine. And most people associate histamine with your respiratory tract, runny nose, itchy eyes, sneezing, wheezing, or skin, itching, flushing, hives. But histamine in your brain is actually stimulating as adrenaline. And that's one of the reasons that Benadryl typically tends to make people sleepy. And there have been times where I have to admit that I have given people several different beta blocker-like medicines to try to suppress their arousal at night. And then I went back and said, wait a minute, do you get hives for no reason? Do you get itchy rashes for no reason? And it turned out that histamine was the major culprit keeping them awake. Again, keep coming back to pain, adequate pain relief. It's surprising to me how many people say, well, no, I don't take pain medicine at bedtime. Why would I take pain medicine at bedtime? I'm going to be asleep all night. And they just don't realize how much pain is disrupting their sleep. And then there are medications, and trazodone is the most effective thing we have for increasing deep sleep. Then I always caution people about conventional sleeping pills, the big three, Ambien, Lunesta, Sonata. These can help people get to sleep, but they do nothing to reduce arousals. They do nothing to increase deep sleep. And in fact, they're often counterproductive because they fool people into thinking they're sleeping well and they're really not. So as I said, I had made a bunch of slides with details because people have asked me, okay, how much of this medicine do I take and which one should I take and how often should I increase the dose? So I can run through a couple of these quickly, but I don't want to spend too much time with this. Propranolol was the first of the beta blockers. The plus and the minus of propranolol is it crosses the blood-brain barrier. So when it first came out, it was not good. It gets into your brain. It causes fatigue. It can cause depression. It can cause nightmares. So it quickly made beta blockers that didn't get into your brain. But a lot of people who have racing thoughts, in addition to feeling physically jittery, do find propranolol helpful. Some of you may recognize propranolol. Propranolol's biggest use these days is for public speaking, performance anxiety. People get up in front of a group and get really nervous. Their heart starts pounding. They get flushed. They get sweaty. They get jittery. You know, they'd like to be a little nervous, but not to the point that your voice cracks or you break out in a sweat. Professional musicians, a lot of people who use propranolol this way. And then we use long-acting propranolol as a migraine preventer because these adrenaline spikes, migraines are triggered by fluctuations. So these adrenaline ups and downs are a common cause of migraine in young women. And that's how we know that we can give large doses of beta blockers to young women with blood pressures of 95 over 65 without making their blood pressure lower. Metoprolol is our other short-acting beta blocker. The other advantage propranolol and metoprolol have is they last about 6 hours. So you don't have to worry that you're going to be hungover in the morning. For some people, 6 hours isn't enough. Natalol is one beta blocker that lasts longer, particularly if you're somebody who drags through the late afternoon, early evening, and then gets a second wind between 9 and 10 o'clock, and then 11, 12 o'clock is the most awake you've been all day. There's no point in getting all wound up and then trying to take medicine to calm down. Take something beforehand to try to suppress that evening surge. Clonidine and guanfacine are interesting drugs. Rather than blocking adrenaline that your body's already made, they basically get into your brain and keep you from making it in the first place. Clonidine was one of our first blood pressure medications back in the 1950s. It was not popular because, as you might imagine, it caused a tremendous amount of fatigue. The adrenaline is what's keeping you going during the day. Suddenly shutting that off, people felt miserable. But a number of patients who find that when beta blockers don't work, that clonidine, again, is a six-hour drug, can really be effective at bedtime. Clonidine is also something we use in some of our asthma patients in whom we often try to stay away from beta blockers. Guanfacine is a similar drug that lasts longer. And I just throw in here, just as an aside, that both of these drugs in the past few years have been FDA approved for the treatment of ADD. So for those of you like me who think that ADD is not a psychiatric problem, it really is an autonomic problem. Alpha blockers have a particular role in sleep disorders, and that is that the vivid, intense, multiple wake up in the morning can recall every detail of your dreams. People who sleep like that, that is associated with that adrenaline binding to what we call alpha sites in your brain. So the beta blockers block the heart rate pounding and the jitteriness and that physical tremors. But binding of that excess adrenaline to alpha sites is what's associated with very vivid dreams, nightmares. And this has significant implications for PTSD. And the VA is doing a major study of use of prazosin in PTSD. It's remarkably effective in preventing flashbacks and nightmares in troops coming back from the war. Generally, patients in this setting use slightly lower doses. Tends to be a hit or miss drug. When it works, it's remarkably effective. And people who've gone from having, you know, wake up in the morning and can say, you know, these are the four dreams I had, and this is what happened in each one, and take prazosin and say, man, I probably had some dreams, but I don't remember any of them. And there are people who need beta blockers and alpha blockers. Benzodiazepines are your Valium, Klonopin, Xanax, Ativan, very double-edged sword. So they have major pluses for sleep. They're sedative, they're anti-anxiety, they have muscle relaxant effects, they reduce extraneous movement. They do offset adrenaline by raising the levels of calming chemicals in your brain to offset the extra stimulating stuff that's running around. But on the downside, they impair cognition, they're downers mood-wise, they impair your motor function, they can worsen fatigue, and you can run into problems with dependence and tolerance and withdrawal. My least favorite of all of these is clonazepam, which is a standard go-to for the sleep doctors because it treats almost anything that could be wrong. You know, if it's anxiety, if it's muscle, if it's movement, here, take this and it'll sleep better. It'll help you sleep better. But clonazepam lasts from 8 to 12 hours. So a lot of people on clonazepam are waking up in the morning and feeling groggy and their head finally clears at noon, and it's not because they haven't slept well, it's because they're hungover on their medication. And often what I say to these people is, wait a minute, you're complaining of fatigue and brain fog and depression, and you're taking a medication that causes all three of those. So just the common benzodiazepines. Pain medications, just the list, and the main reason I put the list up is because it's so short. There's all this fuss about, you know, not prescribing opioids, but if you've got chronic pain and Tylenol doesn't work for you and the anti-inflammatories don't work for you and Tramadol doesn't work for you and you're already taking Cymbalta or something similar like Savella and you're already taking something like Lyrica or Gabapentin or they don't work for you or you have side effects from them, then opioids is what you have left. So obviously they're not first-line treatments. They're about sixth or seventh line. But there are plenty of people who need opioids to get adequate pain relief. I saw a young man recently who unfortunately fell into the trap of the more tired she got, the more she tried to keep going, the more that last little bit of adrenaline kept her going, but she crashed 2 weeks before finals of her freshman year in college. And I saw her and her parents a couple weeks later, and I said, you can spend the entire summer in bed resting, and you're not going to be ready to go back to school in the fall. I said, your tank is empty. You've got to take some time to replenish things. And being a teenager, she didn't listen, and she went home and spent the summer in bed. And when fall came around, she said, no way I can go back to school. So she came to see me, and she said, okay, tell me what I have to do to get better. And I said, okay, here's what you have to do to get better. And in her case, we went down the list and we ended up having to put her on a fentanyl patch to give her 24-hour pain control so that she could get a decent night's sleep and so that pain wasn't sucking up the little energy she had so she could use that energy to exercise and build muscle. And neither she nor I nor her parents were happy about putting an 18-year-old on fentanyl, but she was on it for about 6 months and then was well enough to get off of it. So somebody asked me the other day, do you prescribe opioids? And I was like, yes, only when I have to. But there are times when that's what you need to do. And as you might imagine, she's, you know, offered to speak to anybody who thinks that opioids are overused and have no place in the treatment of chronic non-cancer pain. Muscle relaxants, again, just a different strokes for different folks things. Different muscle relaxants work better for different people. These are, you know, little salient points about each one that I've just found over the years. Flexural, I tend to start with because it's been shown to improve sleep quality in fibromyalgia, which is a chronic pain syndrome, very similar. Their sleep looks very similar to the Ehlers-Danlos patient's sleep. And then others have pluses and minuses of their own. Trazodone, I mentioned, is the single best thing we have for increasing deep sleep. And it turns out that that is actually primarily by blocking the effects of serotonin. So the primary reason why trazodone is the number two sleeping pill in this country after Ambien is that roughly a third of people taking serotonin-type antidepressants, Prozac, Paxil, Zoloft, Celexa, so on, need to take something else at bedtime to counteract the stimulating effect of the antidepressant. And since increasing serotonin levels tends to give you a shallower, dreamier sleep, trazodone is the targeted treatment. Unfortunately, a lot of these people are given Ambien, and that doesn't improve what's wrong with their sleep. They still have a shallow sleep. Amitriptyline similarly increases deep sleep and has some pain effects. So if pain is one of the things that's disrupting sleep, sometimes amitriptyline will be more effective than trazodone. Endoxifen is an interesting drug which increases deep sleep, but primarily through blocking histamine. So again, remember, histamine is stimulating, and doxepin, all of these are 50-year-old antidepressants that we don't use as antidepressants anymore, and the sleep-enhancing doses are about a fifth or a tenth of the antidepressant doses. But the dermatologists figured out that doxepin was useful in some chronic itching syndromes. I tend to use hydroxyzine in those settings. Hydroxyzine is an antihistamine that goes into the brain. It also has some pain effects. It also tends to relieve nausea. It has some anti-anxiety effects. And it doesn't have the a lot of people, and there are probably some here, who have paradoxical reactions to Benadryl. That Benadryl makes them hyper, or Benadryl doesn't work at all. Hydroxyzine is more reliable. Again, I talked about the sleeping pills. I won't belabor that point. They have significant shortcomings other than perhaps helping people to fall asleep. They really don't fix what's wrong with sleep in these patients. Antidepressants, as I just mentioned, the SSRIs, which are really helpful for managing anxiety, depression, and serotonin is calming and helps to offset that adrenaline. So we even use small doses of SSRIs to treat patients with autonomic problems who aren't depressed. But you need to keep in mind that serotonin drugs tend to give you a shallower, dreamier sleep. Prozac is the worst, and Lexapro is the best. Cymbalta, duloxetine, even though it affects serotonin, taken in the morning, does not have a negative effect on sleep. Fetzima is the antidepressant version of Savella. These drugs are the same compound. Savella was originally marketed as a fibromyalgia, as a chronic pain drug. It's primarily a norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor. Big Pharma is not stupid. They said, gee, if this drug is a good norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, then it's probably a good antidepressant too, and repackaged it and remarketed it to psychiatrists under a different name. Tricyclics can improve sleep, but are usually too sedating to use in full antidepressant doses. Bupropion or Wellbutrin is an important thing to recognize because it's the most mood elevating and stimulating and energizing of the antidepressants. The big pearl I would give you about bupropion is that originally it was a short-acting three times a day drug, then they developed an extended release twice a day or sustained release twice a day version. Then they came out with a once-a-day version, which was great because you don't have to remember to take the second dose. Only, unfortunately, with an extended-release 24-hour version, you're getting extra dopamine and extra energy and extra arousal overnight when you don't really need it. So I have a lot of patients who take the twice-a-day version of bupropion once a day. I take it in the morning, kicks in fairly quickly, wears off about 8 or 9 hours later when they're tending to be waning in the late afternoon, early evening anyway. And I know that because when the once-a-day version first came out and we switched people over, a significant number of them asked to go back. And then Remeron is an interesting drug. Remeltion is a mild antidepressant that has sleep-enhancing properties, primarily through blocking histamine, and also appetite-improving properties. So, unfortunately, that's the problem. I don't see too many people here in the room probably who want to have an increased appetite. But for some people who really are struggling with an appetite, it's a very useful drug.
Can I ask a question about the wellbutrin? You said that the sustained release, take both doses in the morning. Like I confused it in my head.
Yeah. No, the sustained release is designed to be a twice-a-day drug, but many people can just take it once. They take it in the morning, and it helps them through the day, and it's wearing off by late afternoon or early evening when they're calming down for the evening anyway. There's some variability. Some people find they take that morning dose, and it's wearing off by 3 o'clock, and they really want it to help them get through that late afternoon, early evening lull. And those people will take a morning dose at about 8 and a second dose at around 2 in the afternoon, rather than 12 hours apart as you would normally do with a twice a day, as a twice a day drug. So after going through all this stuff with my professional colleagues, the typical question I get is, okay, do you have any data to support all these crazy theories? And my only answer is only the two-legged kind. So these are some quotes from patients that are now more than a decade old. And it was only because I started treating people saying, you know, I think too much adrenaline is the problem. I think if we could figure out a way to block the adrenaline, you'd sleep better. You know, hey, are you willing to try it? And fortunately, these people, to some extent, didn't have much to lose. I said, well, I've tried everything else and nothing else helps. I might as well try this. And so these are a number of patients who said that they really were amazed how much these different medications help them sleep. So in summary, hopefully I've convinced you that the most common type of sleep disorder we see in Ehlers-Danlos and similar syndromes is associated with an excess of sympathetic activity. It's just too much adrenaline running around at night. And that medications that can either block that or prevent it from being made or offset it in some way are effective in improving sleep, both as measured by changes in sleep studies and as measured by improvement in symptoms. So I leave you with this, because this is what I leave patients with when I see them, and they say, okay, what do I have to do to get better? This is really the answer. You need to do whatever you can to improve the quality of your sleep. You need to get your pain under control. You need to rest when you're tired and not suck it up and push through the fatigue. You need to make sure you're doing well with your salt fluid balance. You need to take breaks between tasks and limit other stresses when you can. And as you improve your sleep and reduce daytime stresses, gradually you'll replenish the pool. As the pool gets more full, that you'll stop wasting energy overreacting to stuff. You'll have more gas in the tank when you wake up. You'll be able to be more active. The more active you are during the day, the better you sleep at night. The better you sleep at night, the more energy you have during the day. And that improves is how sick people get better. Thank you for your attention. Happy to take questions. So, hopefully not too technical, but.
Any questions for Dr. Pocinki? Trazodone, I go to the Autonomic Center at Vanderbilt. My cardiologist actually said for my POTS, it would make worse. Now that my vital signs are stabilizing, he has given me the option of trying it.
Okay.
But for some reason, he said almost to put it as an allergy, because trazodone would cause me to go into.
Right. So,
I
didn't
understand it. I didn't know what it meant.
This is one of the problems we have in the dysautonomia field, is that we have a study group that meets quarterly of dysautonomia, people interested in dysautonomia in the Mid-Atlantic region, and so there's about 10 of us in a six state area, and typically if someone presents a case, somebody in one of the military hospitals was dealing with a
patient who was 6 months pregnant and having recurrent fainting episodes. And the question was, okay, well, how would you treat this person? And of 10 of us in the room, there were probably six different recommendations. And some of us said, oh yeah, we would use beta blockers. And somebody else said, oh no, you shouldn't use beta blockers. So these antidepressants do worsen orthostatic intolerance. That's conventional wisdom. That's what the book says. Generally, for sleep, we're not using big enough doses to do that.
And I'm not standing.
Right. And hopefully you're not standing. Right. And you've already learned not to jump up quickly in the middle of the night if you do wake up at night. Interestingly enough, prazosin, the alpha blocker, the major side effect of prazosin is lightheadedness. And we're giving it to a population of patients who are already lightheaded. And guess what? It doesn't make their lightheadedness worse. I can't tell you why. But you guys, I think, know you're the zebras. You're the outliers. You're the people that the rules generally don't. You're the exceptions to the rules. So I don't want to disagree with my learned colleagues at Vanderbilt. But what I would say is start with a very small dose and slowly increase your dose. If it makes your lightheadedness worse, then you obviously can't take it. But my experience has been I haven't had that problem with it.
To what degree have you incorporated dietary changes to this?
That's about another hour lecture. So, I mean, dietary changes, I mean, you can look at each one of these things. Salt fluid balance has its own list of, you know, dietary do's and don'ts. The mast cell disorders obviously have a long list of do's and don'ts. Some people do well pain-wise with so-called anti-inflammatory diets. So unfortunately, it's another situation where different things work for different people. Again, there seems to be an increased incidence of intolerances in general and people developing intolerances while they're sick and trying to sort out what those might be. I think by now people have figured out that most people understand that there are a lot of people who are gluten intolerant who have negative blood tests for celiac. They don't have celiac disease, which is an autoimmune disease, but they nevertheless have a gluten sensitivity. And just the common sensitivities that we see a lot, just can people say, well, you know, if something's upsetting my stomach, what should I try eliminating? The most common ones are gluten, soy, egg, dairy, and corn. And just the reason I give you that list is because unfortunately it happens that people say, oh, I took dairy out of my diet, but I'm not feeling any better. Well, it turned out they took dairy out of the diet and replaced their regular milk with soy milk and that they're sensitive to soy also. Corn is a tough one. There's cornstarch in a lot of medications. I mean, it can be very hard to, you know, tons of things are made with corn syrup. But again, diet is just, has got to be an individual thing. It's hard for me to... Yes?
Did you ever try using lidocaine patches?
Mm-hmm.
I think they're one of the...
Yeah, it was on one of my slides. Yeah, lidoderm is a very hit or miss. It's
Come off trademark too,
works,
so you can get it generic.
Works well for, primarily works well for neuropathic pain if you have, sciatica or pinched nerves from a disc or something like that. But the topical treatments are very effective. There's a topical anti-inflammatory patch called Flector, which unfortunately is quite expensive, but I just, on the plane coming down here, was reading a study where they used Flector patch in people after knee replacement. And not surprisingly, these people had better pain relief and had lower use of opioids.
I don't know how this applies to the
topicals are fine. And some people do well with compounded topical pain creams. Again, giving the opportunity to put pain medicine right where you need it and avoid systemic things. Unfortunately, the cost of compounded products is going up and up, and insurance companies are recognizing that and not willing to cover them a lot.
I don't know about the second medication that you were reading about on the way down here. And I have used some of the compounded creams, but for example, the day after Christmas, I fell at the bottom of my steps and I broke three ribs. So I was pretty uncomfortable. I thought I'd try and handle it myself for a while and it didn't work. So anyway, they gave me some lidocaine patches. I went to pick them up and they said, well, your Part D plan isn't going to cover it because the copay is $97. So the girl said, do you have your phone with you? I said, yeah. She said, do you mind if I use it? I said, no, go ahead. She pulled up GoodRx, and I got 10 of them for $28.
Right.
So this may be something, this is something I'm going to do.
Actually, coincidentally, that was my first experience with GoodRx, too. My mother-in-law got a prescription for Lidoderm patches, and it was going to be $350. And I took the coupon from GoodRx and took it to the pharmacy across the street and got them for $110.
Yeah.
So for those of you who are not familiar with GoodRx, there's a number of times. And unfortunately, there are now situations where, because of what are called gag clauses, pharmacists are not allowed to tell you that you could get your medication cheaper if you didn't go through your insurance. Somebody recently told me that their insurance was requiring prior authorization for gabapentin. And I said, I looked on GoodRx, and you can get 120, 300 milligram gabapentin for $13. It's not worth my time or yours fighting with your insurance company to get it approved. It's one of the few things that's still quite inexpensive. Yes?
What type of doctor would you take this information to if you're having trouble sleeping? Because I don't have a good relationship with my doctor.
As you probably could guess, I sorted this out myself because I'd get the sleep studies back and they said normal. I said, well, it can't be normal because you're waking up exhausted. There's got to be something wrong with your sleep. I wish I knew. It's a problem for all of us. I mean, just finding, an orthopedist who understands hypermobility, a physical therapist that understands hypermobility, certainly, right, finding a sleep specialist who, as I said, the reason I spent a couple slides on this concept of first night phenomenon is that might be an approach to take with a sleep doctor to say, hey, are you familiar with first night phenomenon? Yes. Well, that's the way I sleep every night. Yes, in back.
I'm trying to make sense about what I'm going to say because there was a couple things I wanted to just kind of let you know. The Swan Pass patches also work really, really well for me, anyways. Especially for the vitamins, but I would buy those and they really work well. You can wear them for a time. So they're small and thin and they don't fall. And then what I was going to say about the muscle relaxers, I stopped making those even back before I got my EDS diagnosis because. I was dislocating a lot more when I was taking muscle relaxers. And once I realized, yes, they're tying things together, and I've never heard a doctor even say it, but in my mind, I feel like, loosening up the one thing that's holding our joints together, I mean, my fingers and everything was. And once I stopped taking those, and I did switch to the topical, in the topical, I only have used, once every couple months when I have muscle or something, it really was much better. So I don't know if it's true or if it is the case or not on that.
Right. So did all of you hear the question?
No.
Okay. So the concern about taking muscle relaxants is, are you going to make muscles too loose and make your joints looser? All of my patients have heard me say at one time or another, the muscles are tight for a reason. And Susan will support me on this. This is where you have to be careful of the overzealous physical therapist who tries to get your tight muscles to relax, because that tightness is what's holding your joints together. What I'm suggesting here is taking muscle relaxant just at bedtime. And the rationale there is that your muscles are all getting strained during the day trying to hold your joints together, and all those strained muscles then tend to tighten up overnight. And you tend to wake up then stiff and achy in the morning and pull on them and start the whole cycle again. And it's not it's not universal by any means, but that's one thing that people can point to. They say, okay, yes, when I wake up in the morning, I'm not all stiff and tight and sore and achy the way I used to be. So I think the bedtime muscle relaxant. I just saw somebody yesterday who clearly adding a muscle relaxant has made a big difference in the quality of your sleep.
When I stopped taking them, I have children, so that would be any worse. My fatigue is so bad, I get the deepest, wicked sleep. It just, anytime I lay down, I can't get more, I have to stay up all day, but Robaxin, which is a very mild muscle relaxer, I don't know if any of y'all have to take muscle relaxers or not, but I have had a bottle of it forever, but when I do these, when I take one at night time, now if I have to take it during the day, then I make me tired.
Yeah, again, the muscle relaxants are, there's a lot of variability. One of the other things I'm interested in is in pharmacogenetics and how different people metabolize drugs differently. The muscle relaxants are metabolized very differently, so that, right, a lot of people would disagree with you and say Robaxin is a really strong muscle relaxant. And there are some people who can't take Flexeril because they're a zombie the whole next day because they metabolize it much more slowly than normal. So there's a lot of variability among the muscle relaxants. There are some that are generally considered less sedating and more sedating, but that doesn't hold for everybody. I know people who can take very sedating muscle relaxants during the day, and people find the non-sedating muscle relaxants are still sedating for them. So I miss the old days when I would have samples, when I could give people samples of 3 or 4 different ones and say, you know, tell me which one works the best. But yes?
My wife and I are psychiatrists, and I was pleased that you didn't include the antipsychotic medications. We avoid antipsychotics for sleep like the plague, but yet some doctors will sprinkle them on. I'm curious what your opinion is about that.
It's way down the list. I probably have literally a handful of patients who found that a little bit of quetiapine, like 12.5 milligrams or 25 at the most, helps them sleep. That's probably it. I haven't found lamotrigine to be helpful. I know people use it in that setting for sleep. I don't see it as addressing the underlying pathophysiology here. Yes?
I was recently put on one dose of Prozac at night in the hopes to make POTS and dysautonomia and anything better, because Prozac at night is not typically.
Prozac is a very long-acting drug, so what you take in the morning is in your system all night anyway. But I think, right, in general, I would not recommend taking Prozac at night. When we use the low doses of the serotonin drugs for autonomic problems, I'm usually using Lexapro, again, because it has the least negative effects on sleep. The other reason I like Lexapro is that it's commercially available in a liquid. So a lot of people say, oh no, I can't take those drugs. They make me nauseous. They make me drugged. They make me spacey. They make me this or that. And I have to explain that may just be because you started off with too big a dose. And a lot of people, so we'll typically start on 5 or 10 milligrams of Lexapro, and I typically have people start at 1 and then slowly increase their dose.
I would think that you would agree if we could have a lot more of Dr. Enslin in Bethesda, mm-hmm. sleep study. How often would you recommend someone do a daytime sleep study?
Pretty rarely. I can think of it just a couple times when people whose day-night rhythms were totally opposite and they slept during the day, so there was no point in them going to the sleep lab at night. Plus it's really hard to get the sleep labs to to do that. That's not when their staffs are there, so it's hard to do that. The other thing I would shouldn't surprise you, but somebody asked me the other day about when I was making arrangements for have a sleep study, and she said, what are they going to measure? What are they going to do in the sleep lab? And I said, unfortunately, they're going to measure and they're going to do exactly what they would have done 25 years ago. And there are well-respected sleep labs in the Washington area that are using software that is 20 years old. They're looking for sleep apnea. They're looking for periodic limb movements. They haven't found any other things to measure or any better ways to measure them. So there's room for improvement. We need some people in the sleep field who can think outside the box. The one encouraging thing about sleep that's happened very recently is that people in other specialties are getting interested in sleep problems. Mm-hmm. The cardiologists are recognizing that people who don't sleep well are more likely to have heart disease. The neurologists are recognizing that people who don't sleep well are more likely to have cognitive problems. The psychiatrists are recognizing that people who don't sleep well are predisposed to depression and anxiety. So other people are starting to put their fingers in the sleep pie and look at things that the sleep doctors haven't been interested in looking at.
Do you mind my ask.
Let me ask somebody who hasn't asked. Somebody asked a question before. Right. Yeah.
I'm a psychiatrist, and when I look at the rates of depression and anxiety in this patient population, it's higher than the average person with a chronic illness. Is someone doing research about dysautonomia and the possibilities of psychiatric rehabilitations?
You might want to look at a webinar I did on that subject a couple years ago. A couple issues. Yes, the dysautonomias not only are associated with higher rates of these things, but unfortunately, a lot of people's autonomic symptoms are misdiagnosed as psychiatric symptoms, especially anxiety and panic, even occasionally hypomania. The other thing, again, not trying to plug myself here, but another lecture that I give that I get a lot of positive feedback from is on what I call the vicious cycle: chronic pain, poor sleep, fatigue, and depression. And it's very hard for, unfortunately, the way our medical system is set up, patients tend to go to the pain specialist for the pain, the psychiatrist for the depression, maybe to their internist for their fatigue. And you can't break the cycle without addressing all of those pieces together. I'm sure you see that. But I think, that's what I tell people, right? I mean, as long as you're depressed, you're not going to get a decent night's sleep, you're not going to get your pain under control. As long as you're in pain, you're not going to get a decent night's sleep, you're not going to get your depression under control. And then, of course, there are these horrendous lengthy sagas of people who are sick for years and years and years, that without explanation, and often with people saying, oh, you can't be in that much pain, it must be in your head. Or parents accused of Munchausen's by proxy for taking their kids to doctor after doctor after doctor trying to figure out what's wrong with them. So I think there's no surprise to me that depression is a major piece of this. And I think, again, kind of like pain, there's some resistance on the part of patients. Say, well, of course I'm depressed. I'm sick. I can't do this. I can't do what my friends do. I have to go to school from home. I'm in pain all day. Of course, wouldn't you be depressed too? And I said, well, yes, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't address your depression, because your depression is part of your illness. It's not that you're not coping well. This is physiological. We know chronic pain depletes serotonin. This is physiologically part of your illness. There are some studies of panic and anxiety being more prevalent in the hypermobile population. Those were done initially by in Spain, and then more recently by his daughter in Brazil. But there's not a lot, but they looked at both ways. They looked at the Ehlers-Danlos type clinic to see how many people met criteria for panic and anxiety. Then they looked at their panic and anxiety clinics to see how many people were hypermobile. As I said, I've given a whole lecture on how easy it is to mistake autonomic symptoms for psychiatric symptoms. Yes.
What is your ideas of primary mechanisms of
Stay tuned. I'm giving a webinar for the Ehlers-Danlos Society the week after next on the evaluation and management of fatigue and EDS. Yeah, that's another hour to an hour and a half discussion that I think I'll defer for now, if that's okay. Yes, Susan.
When you had mentioned the Apple Watches and Fitbit to kind of monitor your sleep, one thing that I found anyone that does that, because I do it, if you leave it in an exercise mode while you're sleeping, then it picks up the spikes. So like the time, I can't think of the word.
The intervals, it takes more frequent readings or something then?
And there's one that just says like, oh, you don't have to put cardio or anything like that. But so I leave it in that every night. And then that gives me such a better look at where my spikes are. So, it uses your battery more, so you got to charge it money, but it's been a huge...
But you bought the device, you might as well use it.
Well, one of the first things my cardiologist does when I walk in is he takes my phone and he goes to that app so that he can see
I'm surprised how many people don't sleep with those things on, but I guess it's like your watch, you take your watch off when you go to sleep. Okay, how are we doing time-wise? Anybody else who hasn't? Oh, well, Susan, go ahead.
Just regarding Effexor, where does that fit into all of this? Because I've seen a number of patients who have been on Effexor, and I personally was on it for a long time, and...
Right. So Effexor is venlafaxine. Effexor was the first serotonin norepinephrine combination reuptake inhibitor. And actually, venlafaxine does now have a pain indication. It's an interesting drug because at lower doses, it primarily has anti-anxiety effects. At medium doses, it has significant antidepressant effects. And at higher doses, it has pretty significant pain effects. The biggest problem with a lot of these drugs is marketing. I remember when Effexor first came out, and the recommended starting dose was 75 milligrams, and the recommending treatment dose was 150 milligrams. And yet, the pretreatment studies showing a high rate of remission in patients given venlafaxine, the average dose was 310 milligrams. So it's a good drug. The other thing that's uncommon about Effexor is that most of the other serotonin drugs have what we call a plateau effect. As you increase the dose, you don't get that much additional benefit. As you increase the Effexor dose, you continue to get more antidepressant effect. So I at one point had a woman on 600 milligrams of Effexor, which not only helped her pain and her mood, but also raised her blood pressure.
And what about the effects on that and COGS, being aware of an
effort? Without getting into semantics, POTS is a special case of autonomic dysfunction. And most of the patients I see who come to me with a diagnosis of POTS don't really have POTS. They have orthostatic intolerance, or they have some autonomic dysfunction. And the diagnostic criteria for POTS, you could meet the criteria one day and not meet them the next. So I don't particularly find that helpful. But the presence of or absence of orthostatic intolerance doesn't enter that much into my choice of antidepressants. The major choices, the norepinephrine ones have a pain effect, which is often very helpful. The serotonin drugs have some anti-adrenaline effect, and that's why we use them sometimes in POTS. But I don't think the norepinephrine effect, again, unless you get into really high doses of Effexor, I don't think that has a lot of cardiovascular issues that I've seen.
Can you talk about
last question?
Low dose naltrexone and its effect on sleep.
Low dose naltrexone and effect on sleep. I can't say much about it. I generally have not had much luck with it. I know I have colleagues who think it's great and their patients do really well on it, and we've sat down together to try and figure out why my patients don't do so well on it. It tends to be a very hit or miss thing. I have no problem with people trying it. I just, frankly prefer to give them things that I think have a higher likelihood of helping them. That's pretty far down my list. But it has a unique mode of action, and so it's worth trying when other things haven't worked.
Okay, thanks very much for your attention.